IVM.
Welcome everyone to Think Fast, where we talk, don't talk slow, but we think fast. Hello, welcome to Think Fast. I don't know why I'm talking like this. Okay. This is your weekly podcast and everything that's coming up in the world of startup brands, business, marketing. I throw random tech stuff in between and try to make everything connected to the creator economy. Suchita, what do you do on this show?
I basically crack the funnier jokes, number one. Second, I am also like the alpha nerd and I bring all the data and the research to Think Fast. But Varun, what has happened in the past week, man? Aren't you like done with this year? Don't you just want to shut down and move on?
I'm in 2024 mindset, not in 2022 mindset anymore. I think that 2022 is so like yesterday. I don't know. I'm watching some weird content. I feel I'm just having weird accents coming out. But what have you been watching this? What have you obsessed over?
So I think a lot, as mentioned in the first episode, I am still glued to this Theranos thingamajig that's going on and Elizabeth Holmes and everything that she's been up to. I've also been binging a lot on television shows. Sex and the City's reboot and Just Like That launched yesterday. Don't ask me where I got the episode from, but but I saw the first two episodes, which were really something else. But basically, like pop culture and television aside, I also checked out Gaurav Munjal's epic conversation with Shailinder Singh, which I would highly recommend to those of you who are obsessed with all things productivity. What about you, VD? What have you been watching?
I saw bits and pieces of that one, but what I've really been kind of like soaking in is, Adam Newman did this conversation. Adam Newman anyways is very like Yoga Babble founder in that sense, just like makes everything seem so like interesting. First public appearance after what, since the entire madness that happened around WeWork, but I honestly thought it's like a case study in how you can manage narrative, or at least try to manage narrative, try to seem like, if you hear his tone, if you hear just how he was talking about everything, there is zero emotion there, but it doesn't seem like he's lifeless. I don't know how.
But didn't he come across as delusional? I mean, just the way, the flippant way with which he just totally like out of it.
But it was very flat. You know, the thing is that he didn't seem as bad as he could have seemed if he showed even a little bit of emotion, which is what I kind of took from that. I'm like, one second, if you have to come in from where he's coming from, there is no way you're coming out of it with a positive. I don't think he had too much negatives on this one, which is what I've been like. I'm like, how did he talk? Like, I've been actually mapping out how he spoke, and it's a weird thing to kind of map out, but I'm just been looking at that and obsessing over how he speaks.
I think the genius of that interview was, at least I, after watching it, Andrew Sorkin is an expert interviewer, right? Yeah. But I left watching it feeling like there is a lot that happened behind the scenes that none of us were privy to, which I think was the genius of the interview, where he made you like second guess ki actually boss hua kya tha, and how much information do we have access to, and how much of it is actually, you know, just all smoke and mirrors. But genius, delusional Adam Newman, ladies and gentlemen.
And I have to tell you, the most exciting thing of this last week is Casey Neistat launched his filmmaking course, okay? Now, for anybody who does not know Casey Neistat, OG vlogger, he invented filmmaking on YouTube. Like, everybody who's learned, who wanted to vlog online has at some point in time referenced Casey Neistat. He'd made a couple of videos in the past talking about how he vlogs and how you can learn from it. I've watched each of those videos like about 50, 60 times. And now he has a filmmaking course, which I obviously signed up for because I'm a sucker for signing up for courses. But I mean, this is like gold standard. Like, nobody's better than him at... He's basically built... He did a film a day as his daily vlog for, I think, 4 to 5 years.
A film a day?
Yeah, which is basically one vlog a day.
Yeah.
Was it 4 years or 5 years? I don't remember, but it was something like that. It's a long period of time.
Good on Casey. I don't know who he is. So thanks for educating me on yet another creator.
I can talk about Casey for an entire episode, but I will not do that. And I'm going to hand this over to you to say what...
We will take a quick short break and then be back with the funnest segment, which is our Think Fast segment, where Varun and I will ask each other quick questions and get quick responses, hopefully quick responses this time around.
And in case you guys don't come back, you better come back because we have a great guest. We have a guest this episode. So we have a guest coming up down the line. So don't miss on that one. So it's break time. Time for advertising to come.
Don't you think that if everyone around you is getting smart, you better be smarter? Hey there, I'm the traveling professor Siddharth Deshmukh, and I'm back with season 2 of my podcast to make you smarter. Smarter with Sid. What's this season's focus about? Well, it's about 10-minute nuggets that will make you stand out at work. It's time to go from smart to smarter. Tune in every Tuesday and Thursday and become smarter with Sid.
Welcome back to Think Fast, where we're going to do the Think Fast segment. There is still no better way to log into this segment by saying Think Fast twice, but we will do that anyway. So this is where we ask each other like one-liners and we hopefully will answer back in at least two-liners or answer back in a tweet and not an essay. Are you ready, Suchita? Are you ready for this week's Think Fast
questions? You ready, Varun, to not make your question an answer? That is
my questions are always an answer. I have too much context built into my question. So here is question number one. There's a recent tweet that came out about the top 10 songs in Apple Music in the last 1 year. And it basically shows that in India, the top 10 were all Punjabi independent tracks, except for one, which was Badshah's Jugnu, but Badshah's anyway, largely also Punjabi music in that sense. Even the Bollywood tracks in that were independent Punjabi songs that were taken into movies. What's your take on that?
I mean, what else could you possibly expect? I think Punjabi music is like the rap, hip-hop, you know, in the Indian context. And I think, you know, just the amount of talent that's coming out, whether it's, you know, Indian or international, I'm a sucker for a good Punjabi song. Let me ask you, Varun, what's like your epic, you know, number one Punjabi song of all time?
All time is still Sukhbir. You cannot not go to that one OG fair, track. But recent year, it's been a cross between Jugnu and Bijli.
Jesus.
Which are my two tracks of the year.
Jesus. Oh, yes. My question. Congratulations, Varun. Okay, we're getting better at this. Okay, Varun, question for you. CXXO, Sequoia Spark and Female Founder Focus Funds. What is your take on these?
It's great that it's happening and you're finally seeing a clear focus on, I know globally they keep talking about having that middle-aged white man founder and kind of moving away from that. You're kind of having diversity kind of built in, focus a lot more on gender and diversity. It's happening here as well, and it's a great thing to see. I do want to see the fund sizes equal all other fund sizes eventually. I think that's really where we should get to, and I'm hoping that will happen soon. But all thumbs for this one. Up, rather.
Leveling the playing field.
Yes. There would be no glass ceiling if we did not build the glass ceiling in.
Oh God, Varun, just ask me your question, please. Jesus.
Okay. This question will have some context.
You are such a dad. I just want to say you are such a papaji. I swear, you have like papaji, like you like
a
40-year-old papaji. That's my point. Yes. Okay, sorry.
I mean, almost 40-year-old papaji. But okay. So there's a phone that came out called the Fairphone 4. The Fairphone has had multiple versions before because this is number 4. Why it's different from all other phones? Because we've spoken about e-waste a lot across the world. The Fairphone is entirely sustainable. All parts can be taken out and replaced by the people who buy them. So, and I know you are like, I don't give a f- about the new phone, but this is like a phone you can buy. You can just literally replace battery, replace camera, all that stuff and never have to buy an actual again phone again. So what's your perspective on that?
All that's cool, but how much does it cost? Because for me, that's basically what it comes down to.
It's cheaper than most flagship phones. Yeah, it's cheaper than most flagship phones.
And does it like work? And can it not be hacked in by MBS or whoever else is there out there?
I guess some testing will take. It's an Android phone. So I'm guessing that's more up to Android than Google than them. But it's still some testing.
I think it's, done. I mean, definitely, you know, all things sustainability, blah, blah, bullshit have, you know, definitely taken. I mean, all the sustainability is bullshit just before someone jumps to that conclusion. But but generally that, you know, that general
the term
theme
is blah,
has,
blah, not bullshit. I'm just like putting it out there.
No, but, you know, like all things green, renewable, recyclable, climate change, etc., has obviously been a trend for all the right reasons. And it's, you know, great to see technology like this come up. I think with phones, no one quite does it like Apple, right? So I feel like until Apple doesn't make this a trend, Fairphone can keep doing their thing. But up until
I can actually get
Apple
into how Apple
trend,
has become better at this. Their carbon footprint has gone down. I can.
But let's not get into that because I have a question for you,
that's
sir.
An
and that question for you, sir, is BuzzFeed sad SPAC.
I don't think it's unexpected for BuzzFeed's SPAC to be sad because I still don't know what BuzzFeed does anymore. There was a time when BuzzFeed was a thing. I think the digital media side of things has kind of changed, but I feel BuzzFeed is a little lost. I think I take BuzzFeed, take Vice, some of them, I think they're a little lost in terms of what they represent right now. So I'm not surprised, but it's still sad. I mean, they're one of the originals who kind of built this entire thing out. Yeah. So it is sad, but it was expected.
Sadly, I cannot disagree with you. Fall from grace, man. Fall from grace. Remember when like they were like the Mystical Mavericks?
Were a thing. Which Friends character are you?
Which Harry Potter house do you belong to? And then, you know, they had
I think Ravenclaw. I think I'm Hufflepuff. I have to do that again. I have to find that one now. Now that you've said it, I have to find out. What were you?
We'll open that quiz out. No, but like, you know, they did so much. And I think, sorry to like extrapolate on this, but they were one of the OGs of content to commerce even. So, you know, that YouTube channel that they had, Tasty, they actually did a collaboration with, I'm forgetting, either Target or one of these guys where they launched, you know, a set of like utensils and crockery, which tied in with, you know, Tasty's value proposition. So much potential, but so much lost with a couple of the experiments, you know, gone down the drain. But I'm going to stop talking. You have a question for me.
My question to you is, what are you excited about when it comes to 2022?
Oh man, what am I not excited about with respect to 2022? I just hope it doesn't turn out to be a 2021 because I'm frankly pretty done with this year. But I don't know, man. I think you know, in the startup context, I'm excited about how all of these narratives really start coming together. I'm excited about, you know, Web3 and the shape and size that it takes, specifically in the Indian context, now that you're seeing the likes of Sequoia, you know, pick it up, take it more seriously. But just generally, I'm so done with this year. So 2022, whatever you do, just be kind to all of us because it's been 365 arduous days. What about you? 2022, are you going to go back to the Maldives?
No, I really want to do a few. I think I'll get slapped if I go back to the Maldives again. But no, I have lots of trips. I hope to go to Peppa Pig Land in 2022, which is what we're looking forward to in this house.
Peppa Pig Land? Like Metaversey?
You do not know Peppa Pig? Animated
Peppa
character.
Peppa Pig. Oh,
yes, there's Peppa a Peppa Pig Land in the UK.
Papa Varun is back, guys. Papa Varun is back.
What am I excited about beyond that? I'm excited for... I'm also worried and excited for this movie called RRR to come out, which is Rajamouli's next movie after Bahubali. I saw the trailer. I am worried, but I'm also excited. But yes, that's what I'm looking forward to. But more seriously, I'm just looking forward to... there's some really interesting things happening in the creator economy space. You know, Bombay launches... the first creator house in India is coming up in Bombay, which I'm super excited to kind of go to because a creator house where creators can get together. It's a space for them. Seeing a lot of action happening there. And I'm one of the... like I said, the Papaji creators in the between all the younger ones. It's a lot more fun for me as well. Yes, I'm the
Varun
old
is a veteran. Wow.
A veteran. I was called a veteran in an email that was sent to me a couple of days ago. And I tweeted out saying I was called a veteran of an industry and I don't know how to feel about that. I still don't know how to feel about that. I was called a veteran.
Yes, Uncle Ji Namaste was my super quick response. By the way, a quick fact, and you're going to judge me for this because I am so like out of everything, but I have never seen Bahubali. Sorry.
That's okay. I don't think that's a problem. Okay. I think my only thing was I'd never judge anyone for not having seen a movie because, and I don't know if I'll get into trouble for this, Karishma Kapoor never saw Andha Sapna Apna. We did a shoot with her once and she told our director, poor guy wore a Crime Master Go-Go t-shirt and he thought she'll find it cool. And she said, I never saw it actually. So imagine
that. Was she in the movie? Sorry, I haven't seen the movie either.
That I will judge you on, that you haven't seen Andha Sapna Apna, but I will. So that we don't segue into the movies we have not watched.
I want to move into our short segment section. So what are we discussing today, Varun? What are the three topics we're covering?
We're talking about Zepto. This whole like 10-minute, 5-minute, half a second commerce. I don't know where it'll end. It'll be like, okay, you think it and it'll be in your lap. Commerce is what will eventually be. So we're talking about that. Ronnie Scovella invested into 21K, which is the whole edutech one for schools and everything from kindergarten to 12th standard. And we're also digging into this whole VC scene. There's a great article out on Better Capital, which I think is a thing to get into. This is me thinking while I'm talking, which is why I sound suddenly like I've digressed from there. But I'm going to let you kick this one off.
Awesome. So, ladies and gents, the first thing we're going to be talking about is Zepto is one of the very many 10-minute grocery delivery apps that has launched by a bunch of us, by two, three.
Do you know why it's called Zepto, by the way? Do you know what Zepto means?
No.
I actually checked this. Zepto is 10 to the power of minus 21 as a maths piece, which means it's 0.000 something, whatever, like one. which is what the founders thought was cool. And that's why they called it Zepto.
Of course they did. They're Stanford dropouts. Those are the kind of things I would assume Stanford kids found cool. But in any case, this space is heating up. Everyone from Swiggy to, you know, Zomato via Grofers and even Big Basket to some extent. Everyone's really thinking through what their play within, you know, the 10 or the quick delivery or quick commerce, as it's popularly called. I actually, because I care so much about you, dear listeners, I actually spoke with a bunch of my friends who've either been in this space or, you know, have run companies and raised multiple million dollars within this space, just to understand it better. Because I think when you think of quick commerce and when you think of delivery, at least my first reaction was, so much money is going to get pissed away into this. You know, what the hell is even the point, right? And does quick commerce really matter in a country like India, where Kirana stores or general trade have the amount of footprint that they really do? But, you know, in my conversations, I think a lot of what came up was, you know, don't dismiss quick commerce only as, 10 minutes, ha ha, hee hee, hoo hoo, does it really matter? I think the amount of, you know, infrastructure and strength that will really take to build something significant in quick commerce is not trivial. It's not a joke. It's also, interestingly, something that cannot very easily be done by existing players. So if I had to, you know, sort of backtrack a little bit for people who aren't very familiar, you know, typically the models, there's two types of models that exist, right? One is your marketplace models. So for example, Swiggy, Zomato are all three-sided marketplaces. You have your customer, you have your, you know, restaurant or cloud kitchen, and you have your delivery guy, right? And then essentially the technology is, how do you minimize the amount of time in between the three parts of this marketplace, the customer placing an order, the restaurant making that order, and the delivery guy successfully picking it up and obviously delivering it to the customer. Your second model, which is what you've seen the likes of, you know, obviously Big Basket do a kick-ass job of, is your warehousing model, right? Which is a whole other beast. You had guys like Big Basket, Milk Basket, and many others that have come up in this space. I don't know if you remember companies like Pepper Tap and Local Bunya back in 2016. You know, they had also sort of toyed around with this. How do we make commerce? How do we basically make the grocery and the FMCG buying experience for customers simpler? Again, I can keep going on and on about, you know, the copious notes that I got from my friends. But what about you? Were you like me, where you dismissed it immediately, but then once you learned a bit more about the space, you know, started scratching your head saying, bhai, isme kuch hai?
So here's my bigger question, right? And this is actually a question from two ends. One end is that I still am a doubter in terms of why everything has to be within 10 minutes, to be honest. Not everything, and most times, and I know that almost a Kirana store versus this model, but I'm like, how is this better than the Kirana store model? Because in many ways, if I were, let's say, a company like Reliance, who I feel is someone who could actually easily do this, is to aggregate all the Kirana stores across areas and say, make them Reliance branded or Jio brand, whichever one, and make them your both, you know, they can actually be their center. So you're not managing inventory as much and you still have the stores doing it, but you can kind of map it all out, right? Which is where the other question comes in. How does this make business sense in the long term? Because they're doing a few neighborhoods now. Just the amount of inventory you have to hold in each dark store, just to be able to replenish that, how will this make money? And kind of as it scales out is a big question, right?
I mean, we'll find out when we find out. But I think it'll come down to what is the total amount of money going into the segment over a longer period of time? And does it really change habits for customers?
That is so true. I still will call the Kirana store. That's going to be me. Like, hello, chips ka packet hai kya? Speaking of stuff which maybe does it work, does it not work, or should it even work? Ronisku, well, I invested into this company called 21K, which basically is a platform which does everything from kindergarten to K-12, which is like 12th standard, entirely digital in terms of how schools can function. They're saying it will obviously enhance how school happens right now, democratize this entire piece of saying, okay, you could be anywhere in the country, you can still get access to the same kind of education. It's entirely online though. So the students never meet each other. It's entirely done that way. He's putting $5 million into this. And I have many feelings about this. Before I talk about my feelings, which are a lot of feelings, I want to get your perspective on the fact that you're going to have 3 to 18-year-olds literally doing their entire school life online and not really meeting up physically. Lots of emotions. But I'm going to let you come in first.
See, you're the parent out of the both of us, and you obviously like children more than I do, evidently. But
I'll tell you this. Their curriculum includes not just computational thinking, but coding, yoga, dance, music. Yes, so many feelings.
I mean, you know, I think for me, like, the delight of school was the ability to be in a physical environment where it's not just you, but it is others. And it is about you figuring out social cues, social skills, you know, your own ability to communicate, you know, through like words, body language, whatever else. But for me, my schooling experience really came down to my interactions with my peers, my interactions with my teachers. And I think that we really need to stop assuming is that, you know, an average Indian lives in like a sprawling 4 BHK, right?
Yeah, and has great data.
Exactly. And has great connectivity and this, that, and the other. So I think solving for access to education, I still get like solving for access to more and more people having whatever, like access to tutors, teachers, etc. I still get that. But, you know, recreating the experience for kid who could just very well, this specifically doesn't make too much sense to me. But again, you're the parent over here. You're the one who'll have to potentially deal with a kid dancing, doing yoga in your house. What's your take, man? Especially after seeing what COVID does to a kid.
So I've been through this for the last year and almost like close to 2 years now, right? So Leia's done nursery and now a large part of her lower kindergarten off an iPad. And here's the problem with online education in general is that it's not an unbundled format. Like, you know, there's stuff you want to learn which you can do online, which you can kind of need to break out and say, okay, this you can do by yourself, right? So self-learning is a thing now. You talk to anyone who's like a 16-year-old, 15-year-old, which I talk to many of them because they're all saying, why do I have to do this? Why do I have to go to college? Why can't I just learn to be a YouTuber or learn to code or just like talk about, you know, get into crypto and everything else, right? You have that happening a lot. That's because we've said, okay, initially, it was an industrial system of doing education where like we go into class 9 to 5, you're there, you have homework, you all learn the same thing in the same exact way. Digital can change that. And it in some cases it is, which is the good part. The bad part is physical schools, like you said, builds community, right? It brings you together. Like I've made my best friends in life through school, college, just people who I've met. And I feel that that's something you will totally lose if you don't do that. And it also affects how your social skills are. Like how are kids going to like talk to each other? How are they going to be able to? And so some things to be learned, you need to do it together in person. So this whole model of saying it's more efficient because it's only digital doesn't work at all.
So yeah. I think one thing that I'll add is like what I am desperately waiting for. And I think that's where Unacademy is doing some interesting work through like Relevel and the likes is how are you rethinking what the ROI, quote unquote, on schooling needs to be? And who is creating an ecosystem where the ROI is not only measured by what college did you get into? What was your SAT score or whatever else score? Because as long as that is a metric of success, you will see platforms like this continue to exist and, you know, reproduce themselves. But it's disruption of curriculum that I'm...
You know, you mentioned Unacademy. One of the things he said in that talk was interesting, where he said what they want to do is make degrees irrelevant, which I think is an interesting thing to take from what he said. And I think that's important because they are irrelevant in many cases. You just need to learn specific things and go do what you want to do. So,
look at you and me, totally unqualified to
host. I did a 4-year engineering in 6 years. I'm a mechanical engineer. You guys take me near anything mechanical and I will destroy it because I was terrible at it. But yes, this can become a long rant if we don't make this is not a short segment anymore. So we will move on to the next one. What else are you digging into?
So actually, I love this article, which I read in Cap Table. It's on Better Capital and more largely speaking,
one more newsletter to subscribe to people. Please subscribe to Cap Table. Very nice.
Yes, very nice. And no Rohit Shetty happening in Cap Table. CC, last episode that we did where Varun cracked his epic joke.
I'm going to get something for that.
In any case, so Better Capital and listeners, I think one thing that, you know, I'm excited about is newer forms of early stage investments coming in, because you obviously see a lot of your larger funds go into early stage. You know, you're seeing Sequoia with Surge, you're seeing Bloom do a lot of early stage investment. You saw Accel launch Atoms. But outside of just these large funds, you know, sort of going into early stage, I think what's really interesting that's happening now is new types of capital being made available to founders. So for example, when we guys were raising our first round, right, which was our seed round of a little over a crore, it's a pain in the ass to find enough angels come into your round. And then it's a pain in the ass to manage all of those angels and get them on the same page. So Better Capital, which, you know, basically started out as a syndicate, they have recently raised a fund of about $15 million, which will be invested in as growth capital. It's run by this gentleman called Vaibhav Domkundwar, if I got pronunciation correct. They have been on a investing spree. Their overall portfolio has about 185 startups. This year itself, they've made 75 seed investments. They got their first unicorn, which was Slice, and they've got about four companies in their portfolio that are valued at over 500 million, six that are valued at over 100 million. But really the role that Vaibhav plays, right, and the role that, and syndicates again, is becoming increasingly popular in India. You obviously had Let's Venture do it, you know, back in the day. And of course, you've had AngelList, which launched in India a couple of years ago, consolidate how syndicates are run through. But basically, the way a syndicate works is, for example, Varun, if you are running a syndicate, right, you are the one who is quote-unquote responsible for finding deals. So you do the, you know, deal, you do the pipeline creation, sussing out founders. You basically take these deals to quote-unquote partners that are in your quote-unquote syndicate. So you basically, you know, take it to 10 of your friends and you say, hey, this company is good. I'm putting in 5 lakhs. The total round size is going to be about a crore. We should all, you know, sort of like come together and invest in this. And essentially, you also set the terms for the deal, right? So an ecosystem like this is actually very founder friendly, because as a founder, I just have to sort of, you know, work with you. And on the syndicate lead to, you know, people within the syndicate, it operates very similar to, you know, think of it as small case, right? Where you've got like you've got the one guy who you trust, who sort of tells you what, you know, what your portfolio needs to kind of look like. So he's really taken this model and brought a lot of success to it. It's not just him and syndicates as a investment vehicle in early stage, but you're also seeing a lot of super angels come up. So for example, you know, Kunal Behel, through who's the CEO of Snapdeal, through his fund Titan Capital, they've made northward of 150 early stage investments. You've of course got Kunal Shah, who runs Cred. You know, he is, his name is popping up in every other unique fintech.
He's on so many cap tables, it's not even funny.
No, but it's this, right? It's really interesting to see this, you know, like new age investor almost being created. And I think a lot of it sort of alludes to two things, right? One, how much money there is in the ecosystem at large. And I think the second thing that it alludes to is how, even though there is a lot of money, people are looking for, you know, anchors or guides, so to speak, to help them channel, you know, what money to put where and at what terms. What is your, you know, two cents on this ever-changing world of early stage investments?
I don't talk about as much, but I do angel invest quite a bit, about 10 plus investments in the last year and a half. So it's not like I'm putting massive amounts of money, right? What I've realized really helps is that is people want a bunch of things. They obviously, there's large capital requirement, which a lot of them have. And if you go to a larger VC, you're going to get a lot of things in there. But what's been interesting with this trend is that people also want a certain level of like, okay, who can you connect me to? So I've done a bunch of investments in the creator economy space. And every time there, it's more like, okay, because I know enough people, I invest, which means I'm able to connect the founder to 10, 15 other people for whatever they might need, right? From talent to a platform to anybody else, because I can always connect. I can join the dots for them. On the other end, what really everyone's looking for is, can you add to my, when you have a name which is kind of known, in many of these cases, people who are known to put money in good startups, when you go for your next round, people look at your table and say, okay, this person invested. So there is some credibility that comes automatically.
Signaling,
with that. So,
correct. Yeah.
So that really helps as well. So oftentimes, even when I'm kind of looking at someone's deck, I'm saying, okay, I think this person kind of put in money. So also it becomes check mark in that sense. There's a lot of this happening. A lot of AngelList stuff happening as well. A lot of individual deals. The number of syndicates out there now is insane. As you start to get into it, there's so many happening. But the only thing I would caution on is that an individual can only stretch themselves so far. So when you see someone who's done an excessive number of those, what you need to kind of ask yourself, if you are a startup, saying, okay, what kind of backend do they have? What kind of do they have a team that can help me beyond them? Because everybody has only a certain amount of time. So when it's an individual, that's where it gets tricky, where sometimes you might get the check, you might get the name, but you might not get the value. And I think that's the core thing, right? All these guys are doing it well, are being able to do it because they've built a team who helps them do more. So they'll have a chief of staff or have, you know, someone kind of running that part of it. So even if they don't have time, someone's kind of helping out.
No, I think that's a you know, super important point that you made over here, because managing, you know, in the case of, for example, Better Capital, 185 investments is non-trivial, right? And also, especially for early stage founders, giving them the time, bandwidth, and access and information that they need is also non-trivial. So really, and I think that's where, you know, Kunal Behl's Titan VC has done a super phenomenal job, because he's organized how he thinks about, obviously the money, at least from whatever I've read, for the most part is his, it's his family office. Yeah. But the infrastructure that you put in deploying this money, in doing those diligences, in providing, you know, companies with the feedback or the connects that they need to actually, you know, make a go of the money that you've given them, that's really where the, you know, kicker lies. Totally with you over there.
Yeah. I also think it makes it faster for founders, right? You, obviously, you go through a VC firm, go to a larger fund, takes so much more time to get the money in with like an individual or a smaller, like a micro VC. These deals happen very quickly. You just meet someone this week and within like a couple of days, sometimes it happens, if not a couple of weeks at max. I don't think weeks happen. It's mostly days.
Yeah, for sure. I remember when we guys had raised our first round, we were lucky enough to have Rajan Anandan as one of our seed investors, which basically led to this like unlocking of everyone to jump on the board. But I remember, you know, despite, even though we had him and he's added so much value to the way, you know, we've built LBB up, I think one big pain in the ass for me was just managing the whole process, right? Because having someone who's well known, like for example, in your case, maybe you with respect to your friends, right? Having someone put their money in, but having someone create the right terms for the deal are two different problem
statements. So important.
Yeah, and I think, you know, aligning yourself with the right, you know, syndicate leader, so to speak, who can create terms that are founder friendly, help you negotiate those terms with the rest of everyone else, is what really makes a difference. But
before we have on more about this, we can't keep our guests waiting any longer.
Sorry. Hi, guest. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a guest on the other side of this segment. We are massive. Varun, are you excited? Wow, we're growing up.
I'm super excited.
We have
a guest
coming on our show.
We have a guest coming. Wow. Finally, not just us yapping and claiming to be experts. We have an actual expert.
Yes.
But that's after
Is
the break.
It Cinderella? Cinderella. Can you intro our guest by singing Cinderella or whatever the hell
I don't think that
song is.
I'm not going to do that.
The guest will run away.
Exactly.
The guest will run away.
So after this break.
If you're a cricket fan, check out Edges and Sledges, India's favorite cricket podcast.
The podcast focuses on Indian cricket, the IPL, and has a ton of banter both on and off the field.
We talk about the week's biggest cricket stories with current and ex-international cricketers, coaches, or sometimes just between us.
And it's hosted by me, DJ.
Me, Varun.
And me, Ashwin.
New episodes release every week.
You can catch us on the IVM Podcasts website, app,
or wherever you get your podcasts from.
Check out the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast.
Awesome. So guys, we finally have an expert. I'm sure you guys are done listening to Varun and me yap on and on about anything and everything. So we decided to put a sellotape on both Varun and me today and bring on board an expert. And our very first expert on Think Fast is none other than Meeta Malhotra, who, for those of you who are living under a rock, runs this excellent newsletter come a website called The Hard Copy, which is essentially your one-stop shop to all things that you want to know about consumer brands. And she's obviously been in this space for very long, has, you know, spoken to a lot of founders. So we're super, super pumped to have you on board. Thank you for joining us, Meeta.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. It's really fun to be here.
I have my notepad out to take lots of notes, and I'm super excited. I'm just adding in here.
Thank you, guys. I know, and you know, I know you said expert, Suchita, but I'm just going to caveat that and say, listen, I'm going to share my experiences. I'm like, you know, this expert thing worries me. Whatever I've learned and seen in my, you know, in my very long journey, happy to share that with all your listeners.
That's what we're here for. So I want to kick off with, you know, there's so much action that's happened in consumer brands this year. We've seen, you know, shit ton of unicorns come out. There's a massive amount of investment that's finally started going into consumer brands. There's also been multiple, you know, thrasios that have been birthed, you know, over the past year. So if you had to reflect on 2021, you know, what's been of note and how do you really see the coming year play out?
So I think it's been a long time coming. All investment has been, you know, all investors have been obsessed with tech. And I think we're finally at a stage where consumer brands can say we're a consumer brand and not disguise themselves as a tech company, you know, because there was, for a very long time, if you wanted investment, that's all you needed to do. So I think that it's been a long time coming, super excited because India needs many more brands than we've had. So I think this is really great for consumers, great for brand builders. And the money part of it, you know, that's, it's when we talk about obscene valuations or we talk about this sort of tap that's been opened. Look, that's the VC model. It doesn't matter whether it's consumer brands or whether it's tech or whether it was the dot-com boom or neobanks last year. That is how venture capital funds. So we will always see that when there is a hot space. A few will survive and thrive and achieve scale, and many will sort of stay by the wayside, and that is the model. So I'm seeing this last year, very pleased that consumer brands are finally being recognized for what they are. And I think we're going to see some really interesting stuff being built across categories.
So obviously one model that has, you know, finally sort of gotten its acknowledgement of sorts, not just in India, but even globally, has been this House of Brands / you know, Thrasio, Heyday-esque sort of concept. What's your take on that? And both, right? Platforms like Mensa, Ten Club, etc. launching, but also consumer brands that are raising a lot of money like MyGlam and become these powerhouse acquirers of other brands. So what's your take on that?
So I think it's a sound model. Honestly, I know this may be controversial, and I know a lot of people feel otherwise, but House of Brands is not a new thing. It's existed forever, right? And Unilever's and P&G's have been around for decades. Now, let's just step back and look at how a brand is built. So, you know, what are the three or four really big things, right? One is the whole manufacturing supply chain aspect. One is the whole marketing distribution aspect. And then, of course, you know, there is the people piece, all of these. And then finally, the big elephant in the room is the distribution piece. Now, all of these presented huge obstacles to young brands before the internet really came into its own. You couldn't, even if you had the best idea in the world and you put together the best product in the world, cracking offline distribution is not for the faint-hearted. It requires very deep pockets, and it's a very, very tough thing to do. And there just wasn't enough capital available to even fund people who were attempting to do it. What's happening now is that all the pieces are falling into place. The internet is allowing you to launch your brand, experiment with it, reach your initial set of customers. You know, I talk to entrepreneurs every other day who very quickly, within a year or two, have got to a 5 crore plus annual turnover. And they're hitting them. They're going from 5 to 10. It's after that that the trouble starts, right? Because then what happens often is that you need to hire. You need to hire people who know how to take you to that next leg of your journey. And that's where they're hitting sort of this wall. I think that the Thrasios will solve for, you know, the Thrasio lookalikes will solve for each of these things. And when whoever does that successfully is going to create a successful House of Brands. So we have to wait to see how many of them will do it successfully. And I'm not commenting again on, you know, what are the financial aspects of it? How much money have they raised? Yes, there's a fight in the market for valuable brands. What price are they going to acquire them at? All of those things are going to determine whether 5 years down the line, if you invite me back on this podcast, we're talking about, okay, who succeeded and who didn't. Right. But as a model, saying that very quickly in a market that is benefit of brands, we will acquire promising brands and give them the inputs that they need to scale is a fundamentally sound one. Not just the Thrasio kind of companies, but like you said, you know, larger companies are doing it. Unilever's and P&G's have done it for decades. Because it's quicker, it's faster. Yeah,
and just to double tap on that, when you think of like moats specifically within each of these, you know, Thrasio lookalikes, right? Do you see this over time becoming, Mensa sort of sticks to fashion and, you know, doubles down on expertise over there versus someone else, you know, sticks to beauty or FMCG and doubles down over there? Because even building infrastructure for each of these categories is not the same. So do you see these guys really, you know, picking up like a lane and sticking to it? Or, you know, are there underlying expertise that you feel can be leveraged even across multiple different categories if that's the strategy that one of them takes?
I think we'll see both kinds of models playing out. I think that we'll see players who, you know, in the next couple of years see that, look, it's just taking too much capital, sticking to perhaps a lane, sticking to a beauty or sticking to a fashion. But I think the larger players, and you know, I can't claim to know what Mensa is doing, and but a player like Mensa, which is so well funded and has that expertise, could very well go start with something they're very familiar with, like fashion, because after all, having built Roadster and you know has that experience under his belt. There's nothing to stop them from going into, say, adjacent categories quite quickly, like from fashion to beauty.
Yeah.
That's not such a difficult thing to do.
As the number of brands increases and all this is happening, it also gets trickier to how do you not get lost in the sea of brands, right? Because now there's so many D2C brands out there. There's so many newer brands kind of coming out. And obviously now the house of brands thing happening. Again, you're talking about it's just like the volume has increased. What have you kind of seen that's making certain brands kind of stand out and others kind of just being part of the whole? I think that will be a good one for people to kind of get into.
Yeah, I think that let's double tap on this D2C brands first. Mm. And this is one of my pet peeves. So D2C brands, especially the younger ones, they focus, you know, they're very, very good because they have an immediate connect with their audiences, right? Many of the stories we hear of entrepreneurs, their brands have been born because of a personal pain point. So I didn't find like a great mixer, I started one. I didn't find great athleisure, so I started this. And so that means they have a very deep understanding, better than the bigger companies, of their immediate. Where they fail is execution, the back end, right? And I've said this again and again and again. I see a lot of, I don't have data for this, but you'll discover a D2C brand, maybe on Instagram, or you know, your friend will tell you or something else. And then you will go order them on Amazon. That is because you don't trust their execution. And even when I've tried, I personally sort of always say, no, I want to order on their own website. They just haven't put in the thought that's needed into just that fulfillment. And that's where they break down, first of all. So the three or four things I talked about, that doesn't change, Varun. That stays the same, no matter whether you built brands 20 years ago, whether you're building brands today. You've got to crack each one of those. So you can't just focus on your pretty packaging and your activist outlook. And all of those are great for initial growth, but we are not going to deliver and you're not going to fulfill. It's going to peter out very fast. So that's one big moat. People who build execution capabilities really fast, that is going to be a moat that, you know, a lot of younger brands will find hard to breach, which is why I'm bullish on the Thrasio-like models. The other thing, of course, is the time immemorial moat, right? If your customers love you, really, and believe in what your promise is to them, that moat has proven hard for the biggest companies to breach. It's the buy versus acquire question. Why does a Unilever, with all the expertise in the world, all the resources in the world, they can hire anyone, why do they need to buy? They need to buy because they know that they are unsure of replicating that bond between the brand and the customer. That magic, there is no real, you know, formula for that.
Can you give examples of brands that have done a really good job of this? So examples of, you know, brands that have built that customer bond and have really been community first?
I think people who've taken a very strong stance. One of the mistakes that, again, younger brands do is they tend to be safe and generic. It's going to be very hard to get attention. Like you said, there are just too many brands out there. So I would say a Whole Truth food, right? Now Shashank took such a strong stance and that got attention. So he lives it. He lives it entirely. And you know, his customers believe that this is true and what he's talking about. And it's way beyond buy my product, which is sort of the best way to build a brand. You're not just pushing product. You're actually talking about a much bigger thing and you're getting your customers to buy into that vision with you. And you're making them understand how that vision is important in their lives. So he's from Unilever. He knows how to play the game. But yeah, to me, he stands out. And then, of course, you have Sugar that has done a brilliant job again of understanding their audience, really figuring out that there's this whole section of women who didn't want who weren't being addressed by Lakme, were not the MAC/Clinique spenders. So nobody was really talking to them. And who were these people? And then again, building that sharp personality of saying fearless, opinionated women, willing to experiment, and then sticking to it. You know, I saw their offline campaign recently, and it said, makeup that lasts, I think, something like that, for the bold and fearless or something. And I was so happy because they're just staying with that. They're not deviating. And when they do that, they're building a very strong connection with their customers.
I think also the interesting part about what you just said, right, is the fact that you've seen a lot of these younger brands kind of come in, just focus on performance, kind of let's get as much sales in, and eventually at some point try to build a brand. But what you're saying, I think, makes total sense, that you need to think of that from day one. You need to kind of live it from day one and not kind of slap it on, let's say, after you raise your Series A, which seems to be the trend in many cases.
God, again, pet peeve. I could really, I'll tell you, I can go on for so long on this because, and I really blame the investors also, right? Because see, there's so much jargon in our industry, growth hacks and God knows what all. Brand is equated to advertising, and everybody says that, oh, you don't need to build a brand yet. You just show some growth so you can get your Series A. That's the formula. And that's completely wrong. So let me give you a very concrete example. In the last week, I think two young entrepreneurs called me, and you know, this is what I do. I love speaking to the people like that, and they both hit two different segments. One was beauty, one was food, and they both hit a 7 crore annual turnover, which is, you know, remarkable just by themselves, bootstrapped with friends and family, say whatever. And they said, you know, we don't have a brand now. We don't know what to do now. We are, you know, tell us what should we do. And I said, you know, first of all, that statement is incorrect. If you have customers, you obviously do, who are giving you 7 crores of rupees a year, you have a brand. They think something of you. Now, that may not be what you want them to think of you. They may think of you as, oh, this is cheaper to the brand that I've been buying, so let me switch to them. They may think, I don't know, it's available online, so let me buy. So maybe they don't have the bond that you want, but you have a brand. Now, your job is to figure out what they think of you and shape that narrative to a desired place. You know, and that's not going to be only through saying, acha, you know, should I launch a TV ad? There's this, again, this misconception. I can't build a brand because I don't have a budget to, you know, sponsor an IPL team or launch a TV ad. So just so much confusion and this overemphasis on performance marketing, which has its place. But, you know, even if you're doing performance marketing, you're brand building, aren't you?
Yeah, so true.
How are you not? So,
absolutely. Yeah. I want to segue into categories, right? Because this year, you know, in between like MyGlam, Sugar, Mamaearth, and, you know, acquisitions that they've all made, Dot & Key getting, you know, quite, Nykaa's obviously ginormous IPO. Beauty has been this, like, you know, like the hot property of 2021, right? What would you, you know, put your money on in the upcoming year? What are those, you know, undisrupted categories where you see more interesting brands being formed?
So I wouldn't put my money on a single category. I think beauty will continue to grow. But the way I look at it is, look, you've got that holy trifecta of fashion, beauty and food, right? That is going to continue to grow. What I'm looking out for, which hasn't happened in India so far, and maybe with now all these, you know, Thrasio, well-funded Thrasio-like companies may happen, is what were essentially considered commodities. Can they be made into brands? Like unsexy, boring things, you know? And people have done it and built the best companies in India out of it. So Asian Paints is a great example of somebody who took what was essentially a commodity, paint, and attached a whole lifestyle to it and said it's about, you know, the pride in your house. And look at how successful a company they have built. Yeah, all of that. And then there's Titan, which, you know, their whole philosophy has been enter an unorganized sector and organize it. So now it seems self-evident, oh, Tanishq is such a big brand, but actually they've done it very mindfully. They, you know, there was only a family jeweler, and then they went in and organized that sector and started this idea of branded jewelry, which everybody has followed. So I'm really, more than thinking about which category, I'm looking to see who's going to, there's so many unorganized sectors in India, who's entering those and starting to brand them. And I think that's going to be a really exciting play.
And if I had to double tap on that, right, because that here is where branding commodities becomes fairly tough because, again, of the nature of even distribution engines are broken, right? So if you had to sort of, you know, give first principle ways of approaching how do you brand a commodity, how do you create character, you know, when you're selling basically like a wall, what are the things that entrepreneurs listening in can, you know, lean on?
I know this is a boring thing to say, but my first and even maybe last piece of advice is listen to your customers. So, you know, let's take an example of, say, PSafe. Somebody, I don't know what the parent company is called, but, you know, he took what was essentially available, but then branded it for a very specific consumer pain point. Hey, when I'm traveling, I'm not sure how hygienic the toilet is. It wasn't as if that commodity was not available earlier, but it wasn't branded and packaged to address a specific customer need. So I think that's what I would say. And whenever somebody asks me this, I think they, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs get really annoyed with me because I just say, you know what, go talk to 10 of your customers, you'll have your answer. And that is what I would say. Whatever you're doing, and if you're stuck, first of all, figure out where you're stuck. What is that question that you need to answer? And then really just go out and have informal chats with 10 or 15 of your customers. You will see the light. And that light could be, I don't want to listen to them. Or it could be that, hey, one of them has given me my answer. But either way, the solution will lie with the customer.
You used the term pet peeve a couple of times. My biggest pet peeve in life is to connect everything to the creator economy. And we've seen that happen. We've seen consumer brands come out of creators in other markets. In India, still hasn't. They haven't gone beyond merchandise, etc. Do you see that as an area that kind of grow? Because there is interest. I know a bunch of them are working in stealth on this right now. But just because we only had celebrities do this so far, we haven't had so-called internet creators kind of do this as well. Are you seeing that as an area that can kind of grow?
I think it will take a little bit of time, Varun. So, you know, India has been very much a Bollywood market, and that it's going to be very hard to change that. So even the initial success we've seen, whether it's in fashion by Salman Khan and Hrithik Roshan, or whether it's, you know, like Suchita said, it's Katrina and Alia with beauty, we're still seeing it come out of Bollywood, right? Because there's this trust and belief in Bollywood that is very hard to rationalize in India, but it is there and it's very hard to take away. Now, will an internet creator, regardless of how many followers he or she has, be able to inspire that same kind of trust where I will go buy a product? I don't have an answer to that yet. I think it will take some time. Because, you know, there is a delta between me watching an internet creator, enjoying what they do, being their follower, versus buying a product which may not be directly linked to their, like their entertainers or musicians, or, you know, if it's a product that's not directly linked to what they do, it's going to take some convincing. Internet creators will have an advantage, of course, is distribution, right? So that's like a big advantage, that they'll be able to get the distribution up and running much faster than, say, normal brands.
The interesting part of how a lot of them are looking at it, and whoever I've spoken to in recent times, and that I thought, and just it's a different way from how other consumer brands do it, is that they all look at it as small batch drops. They're not looking at it as, okay, I'll go deep, create like massive volume. I will do a product. I will do a certain limited amount of it and sell it. I don't know how that is scalable, but and is there something from this that, let's say, larger consumer brands could kind of borrow and say, okay, let's do a small batch or do like a exclusive range. Do you see that there's a learning for each of them with each other?
I think so. So if that's how they're looking at it, then that model makes perfect sense, right? Because then I am buying that drop, that limited edition drop. And this is a proven model. I think creators in the West have been doing this for a very long time. Then I'm buying that because it's because of my relationship with that creator. It's not because that I want to buy a face cream, or I want to buy a pair of sneakers, or I want to buy a pair of headphones. I'm doing it because I love this creator and he or she is offering me this, and I'm just going to do it as part of my relationship with them. So limited drops makes perfect sense. I think that what we'll see as this catches on is that certainly larger companies will seek collabs. I mean, that's going to happen for sure. And they will do it because they will want to reach those audiences, and they will want, you know, some rub off from that brand association. So, I mean, you've got a Balenciaga and Fortnite. You know, five years ago, somebody would have said nonsense. Like, that's just
Yeah.
You're talking rubbish. You know, people I know in the traditional international fashion industry, I mean, that industry is more old-fashioned and rigid than anyone, right? But today it's happening. And we'll see more of it happening because there is this fear that things are moving so fast now that people don't want to be left behind.
I want to sort of, you know, switch into moats that you've seen come up because I think what's interesting is every category is so different, right? You had Epigamia really build their moat, you know, with respect to cold chain, right? You've had Licious that's been able to crack something that similar to, you know, how you're describing Titan, right? Take a commodity, but really standardize the experience for a customer. But each of these categories has a very different MO, right? They have a very different sort of infrastructural layer that's needed to actually build and grow. And unfortunately, or for better or for worse, you're seeing a lot of younger brands lean on, you know, just having Instagram community as a moat while there's actually so much more that can be explored, whether it's an infra distribution, supply chain, whatever else. What are the interesting moats that, you know, you've seen being built out maybe by some of the younger, more emerging brands that you've, you know, interacted with? And for young entrepreneurs who are looking at launching stuff within the consumer brand space, what are the things that, you know, you're still seeing not being leveraged enough by entrepreneurs?
I think supply chain is, you know, if you can get that, it's easy. Look, that is a huge moat. Supply chain is possibly one of the biggest moats you can have. And it's getting easier. I think even in food, the reason these brands have been able to come up is because, say, you know, cold chain, say, 10 years ago, it was impossible. It was just too expensive. But today, it is possible to start thinking about launching an ice cream. You could. Whereas earlier, I mean, forget it. No one could launch an ice cream. So I think that in that sense, those moats have become slightly diluted that you can, people can get in. At least they can breach the category. They can enter the category. To me, the single thing that I see as a problem, and I really admire specifically, say, Mama Earth or Sugar, who would you say in food, maybe an Epigamia, who have scaled. The problem lies in going from being this wonderful product loved by your Instagram community to really being available across India, because that's, you know, ultimately that's what you need to do, being where the customer is. Despite all the hype, let's not forget what percentage of our retail is online. 10-11%? I mean, you know, negligible. Everybody else is still shopping offline. So if you're, it's negligible. So don't get carried away with that. Use it to build and experiment and understand, but always know that if you're ambitious, see, I mean, it depends on the scale of your ambition. It's perfectly fine to build a lifestyle brand online and stay there. But if you want to build a large brand, you have no choice but to go offline. And I remember speaking to Neeraj, you know, of Paperboat. And he told me that for the longest time, his father would say, I don't know what you're doing and, you know, whatever. Because I think the father stayed in Kanpur and, you know, next in the Kirana shop close to their house, Paperboat was not. So he was like, if you're not available here, then what kind of brand are you building? And that's the truth. That is really the truth of India. You have to crack that distribution. So it's too early to, I mean, Licious, all of these guys have done a fantastic job cracking supply chain. I think that's an amazing moat. Like I said, there are consumer moats being built like Whole Truth has done, like the beauty brands have done. But finally, what scale will all of these guys achieve offline? I think we'll, you know, the next 3 years will really tell us that. I think a few have got escape velocity, like a Mama Earth. I mean, a Wow. If you've crossed your 500 crore mark and you're available offline, that's you. You've already done a lot of the hard work is behind you. How many will reach that mark? We still have to see.
If you had to make predictions, right, for what the future holds and if we, you know, and if we were magically able to produce $100 million to you and ask you to invest at either brands, categories, or even entrepreneurs, right? Where does Meeta's buck lie? Like, what would you bet on?
I would bet on the really more boring categories, you know, like
bed sheets.
Like I loved, like Go Colors. To me, that was always a winning, you know, every time I saw them, I think, you know, even a few years ago before they became so well known, I would see them and I would think, oh my God, this is amazing. What a fantastic idea. So I would bet on all those unsexy categories, which seem like just commodities, which people today buy largely from unbranded sources. And I would go in there and really create an interesting brand, a simple brand. You know, it doesn't have to be hype. Like, I think Go Colors is an amazing brand. They just they cracked it with offline distribution. They are everywhere you go. They are priced sensibly. And yet they are something that, you know, every Indian woman wants. So it doesn't get better than that. That's where I would go.
And also, like, genius in terms of how they, you know, like you said, thought of distribution, right? I remember when I was talking to Sakshi from Sequoia, she mentioned that they literally opened next to, you know, one of these like hot kurti selling, like your global desis, etc. of the world, because, you know, you need to pair those, that kurti or that tuning that you're buying with, you know, Go Colors. And it's just thinking through the use case for the customer and plugging yourself in there. That's where that delta came from.
Exactly. And like you said, it, you know, finally it's about
I need to update my Go Colors knowledge.
Varun needs to start wearing colored tights.
Listen, if you're traveling, look for them.
I'm going to update my...
So that, I think there would be so many opportunities for, you know, Go Color like brands in India. There would just be so many. And keep it, you know, keep it simple. People get so carried away with the hype. Do what they've done. Just good, solid business sense.
Just kind of like, get a perspective from about categories, right? Even like something like beauty, which has been over-indexed, and how much there already is over there. What's within the stuff which you already see a lot of, which people aren't looking at which is like a great opportunity. I'd love to get from you saying, because there are pieces over there which, while it seems crowded, there's so many gaps.
Varun is looking for business ideas, Meeta.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. So I'm digging for business ideas over here.
Gosh, if I, if I had the 100 million and the business ideas, then, you know, I would be on Shark Tank and not on Think Fast, I think. That's another great thing that's happening, huh? I'm so happy that they're finally doing a sensible thing which makes sense for India. Like, I'm just
right
praying that it becomes ABC-like, because that's what we need. So in beauty, go back to your question, what categories? I don't know what specifically in beauty, really. I can't think of a category, but something that I'm kind of bullish on is this intersection of beauty and health, which is like this whole nutraceutical. We don't have enough of that in India. Very few, hardly any. And now with this whole, like, we're seeing this whole health wave emerge, right? And I think that there's a play.
You know, the number of gummies I see on my Amazon feed, I have in full disclosure, I am having two random gummies a day because I like testing these things out. I have bought...
Aapke ghane baalo ka raaz, Varun.
Technically, yes. One biotin gummy for the hair. One gummy, which is an apple cider one. And I have found this weird... strips you can put on your tongue and they melt in, which give you everything from vitamin C to everything else, which feel oddly connected to some ways to infuse drugs, which I've heard about and never really have gone near. I'm just like putting it out there. But
are you eating magic pops? Are you basically telling us that you've been consuming a lot of magic pops? Varun is stealing his daughter's sweet loot.
That's what's happening. I have a candy stash room cabinet.
We used to do that. We used to wait for the kids to come home from birthday parties and then have their
magic pops.
But gummies are new candy. They taste like candy and they're supposed to be healthy. That's going to be my category to look at.
Okay, guys, we know what Varun's going to launch. Meeta, wait for it. He's going to launch a nutraceutical magic pop gummy thingamajig. Yeah, and brand it with your hair, Varun. Brand it with your hair.
This is my newly...
Please call me.
But thank you so much, Meeta. This was absolutely awesome. I know we've all taken a bunch of notes, and I absolutely love what you said about, you know, going back to solving the simple, boring problems. But that's really where, like, the delta of opportunities lie. And if you look at, you know, any of the successful examples, they're cool brands, but what they've really done is solve the simple shit, and that's where the magic's come from.
Yeah, I think that at the end of the day, that's what will endure, Suchita. And I know a lot of people don't want to hear
endurance.
Yes, to endurance. Here's to endurance. Yes. And here's to a million Indian brands being built. I'm so happy to see it happen, finally.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for joining us, Meeta. Listeners, Make sure you check out the hard copy and subscribe to it. It's absolutely awesome. Varun and I get all of our consumer brand dope from there. So thank you so much, Meeta, for doing what you do. And thank you for joining us.
Thanks. Thanks.
Thank you, guys. Thanks, Suchita. Thanks, Varun.
Okay, that was, I felt like I learned so much. I know that we claim to be experts, but that was an actual expert and I learned a lot. Going to be doing a lot of gummy. My gummy theory will survive. I'm telling you, gummies will take over everything.
Or magic pops.
Speaking of magic pops, you know, I forget what the thing was. You know, you should get that candy which you put in your mouth and you start like patawing inside.
That's magic pops, mere bhai.
Correct, that's magic pops. Oh, yeah.
Oh my God.
I'm getting old. Okay. Getting old. This episode is about how I've gotten old.
Basically, we should title this episode Papa Ji Varun.
Yes. So before I make any more old person things, what are your recommendations for this week?
So I have been like de-stressing from a long week at work by watching this absolutely excellent show. Mindy Kaling is back and how. She has a new show called Sex Lives of College Girls. And basically like think of it as 2021 version of, you know, that HBO show Girls or like Sex in the City, except... Mm-hmm. You know, in the context of college girls. So you've got an Indian girl, you've got like this, you know, like Midwestern girl, you've got this closeted LGBTQIA, you know, character on the show. And it's such a fun, relevant new age version of these old school shows like Girls, Sex and City and the likes. And I think the other thing that I want to add is, it's so lovely to see someone also set the narratives for what is right or wrong in the college context. I didn't go to an American university, but you know, from friends who went to, you know, like the Whartons or the whatever else is of the world, you hear great stuff, but you also hear horror stories of, you know, what really goes down in college and what was considered acceptable and unacceptable back in the day. So I think Mindy Kaling does a vataj, you know, job of really setting the ground rules of what, you know, women should look at as acceptable and unacceptable in the college context. I will not tell you the source of how I saw this show, but ladies and gents, if you can find your way to the show, must watch. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful show.
Two things from very parallel lens. I came across this documentary on the first ever smartphone that was made, which is not the iPhone, none of those things, right?
Was it
this company called Handspring. There's a half an hour documentary, The Verge made it. It's on YouTube. So just go to The Verge channel on YouTube. The company was called Handspring. And a lot of the stuff which you associate with the modern smartphone was something they did. They were just like, before their time, a lot of stuff just was done wrong in that sense. But it's a great to see what it was. Like they talked about like there'll be data coming into our phones and we'll be connected to the internet and all that stuff way before even Steve Jobs did that, you know, that iconic keynote. So that's a good one to check out. And I'm also watching Hawkeye, which is the next Marvel series out on Disney Plus. It's amazing. It's great. It's like having a Christmas movie version of a Marvel series, which is the perfect combination of things. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of good time pass fun. So yes, that's what I'm... Very parallel things I'm consuming, but...
Yeah, but I know my homework. I need to watch Andaz, Apna Apna and Bahubali this weekend.
No, actually, instead of watching Bahubali, watch the documentary. It's great.
What is it called again?
It's called, it's on, there's the Verge, which is the publication, then it's on the YouTube channel. Uh-huh. It's a documentary that's basically, it says the secret history of the first real smartphone. The company was called Handspring.
Nice, nice, nice. Interesting. And with those recommendations, ladies and gentlemen, we have come to a conclusion of episode 03. Yes. Think fast.
Yes. Think fast.
Good job, Varun. Think fast, Bolli. We actually thought fast.
I will not do the Bacha line again. I'm just going to like think fast. I'll do this how we started off this episode, saying think fast, guys. This is a think fast episode. Think fast. Gotta think slow now. Go to sleep.
Bye.
It's almost end of 2021. Goodbye.
See you next week.
Bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Hey, everybody. It's been another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. On Raw and Organic, Kunal is joined by Divyanka Bedi, aka Gigi. She's the owner of a fitness studio called The Space in Mumbai. They discuss how the pandemic changed everything and how to start building a community. one of our favorite shows, The Habit Show, completes 3 years and 600 episodes. Congratulations to Ashton and the rest of his team. Good habits lead to consistency. Ashton clearly has them. 3 years and 600 episodes is an amazing achievement. In the world of Simplify, Chuck, Naren, Shriket, and Tony try to find out how distressing it is for billionaires to be taxed on their income. On All Things Policy, the Takshashila folk unpack the findings of the National Family Health Survey. And on Paisa Vaisa, Anupam talks to Preeti Khurana. She's the Director of Advocacy and Regulation at Clear, and they discuss filing your income tax return. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And also do check out our YouTube channels. We have a number of them. You can get them on ivmpodcast.com/YouTube. And remember, if you're enjoying this show, or any of our other shows for that matter, please do tell a friend. It really does help us spread the word. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors for the network this week, Cred, Bank of Baroda, CoinSwitch, Kuber, Intel, and Oxfam India. Thank you so much for making this possible.
Come learn and experience the ABCDs of being queer with me, Shunetro.
And me, Farhad.
On our show, Gay BCD.
The two of us take you through our stories and experiences of being gay men in the city of Mumbai and have candid
and sometimes downright scandalous
conversations about sexuality, gay culture, and everything in between.
Catch new episodes of Gay BCD every Tuesday on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get all your podcasts from.